Please welcome Birgitta Jonsdottir. Welcome to the show. I'm sorry, I can't do this in Icelandic, so we need to speak English, if that's okay.
That's okay. And when I speak Scandinavian, I sound like a child.
Okay, that's good. Yes, let's stick to English.
Yes.
How would you fit in the House of Lords, do you think?
I don't think I would fit there. I would rather fit in the House of Commons. I come from a very common background, but I fit in with this crowd because I am an artist. I found a new name for what I am now. I'm a poetician, not a politician.
I don't agree with you about the Lords, actually, because they're not the particularly posh lot anymore. That's gone.
Yeah, maybe, but I'm not British, so, you know, I guess I'm never going to be a lord or a lady.
You've done very well in the Icelandic election 2 weeks ago. And I don't know, it's not really settled how it's going to be there now, but have you ever dreamt about becoming the prime minister?
Yes, I did actually have a nightmare once in the year 2000-something. Which I then wrote in a poem. It was called Letter for You, where I described this nightmare. It has never been a fascination to me to acquire power or become power, rather. Having been an activist all my life, wanting to change things, to have this big megaphone and to go in a job interview with the nation is an incredible experience.
And what you promote is something you call Robin Hood politics.
Being a pirate today really means, you know, when the great grandmother says, I'm a pirate, she's meaning I want to be part of the change. And in a sense, all what we're seeing, like that's happening in the United States and in various other countries where you get the extreme right, where it's usually driven on an external fear, we're trying to find a way to motivate people to feel part of the change, that they actually have a voice and a way to facilitate that voice into the parliament. Mm. And the Robin Hood of politics is a little bit like Robin Hood was a pirate. He took the wealth from the wealthy and distributed to the people where he felt that the wealthy had stolen it from the people.
So that's what you want to do?
I was actually started to use this metaphor more like we want to take the power from the powerful and give it back to the people so that we truly have the rule of the mob, which democracy means.
Well, this is...
Hold on to your castle now.
No, it's exactly what we were saying, that in a sense, Brexit, Trump, is all reflecting a very similar philosophical position, that we are having to respect the voice of the people instead of ignoring and patronising them and simply not listening to them, which has gone on for so long.
It has gone on for a very long time, but at the same time, I feel the path that's been taken in the United States and also a lot around the Brexit campaign, there were negative consequences, both in the United States and in the UK, where you use xenophobia to justify system change. And I find that to be unacceptable. And
yes,
I want to find...
I wouldn't put too much onto that.
Well, I have friends in the UK, actually a former lord and his wife. They have been harassed because she is not originally from the UK. We have to understand what driving on this negativity and fear, like Trump did in particular, and some members of UKIP did as well, in the UK, and I follow these things very closely. I am...
You're right. I wouldn't disagree with that.
If you compare what you're doing in Iceland to America or to what's happening in England, do you agree that you're sort of channeling the same or a similar discontent?
Yes and no. We are...
Choose. Yes or no.
No, it's not only about that, because like 40% of the people that support the Pirate Party in Iceland are between 18 and 29. So we are appealing to the younger generation. We're helping the young people to find a home in politics.
Yes, but below that, it's about some kind of anti-establishment, isn't it?
Yes, it is. And what I would say about xenophobia and racism and all the rest of it is I think most of it comes out of fear. Mm-hmm. And fear of being bullied, fear of being pushed around, fear of not being taken seriously, being made second rate, second class, whatever you call it. And I think if you can get through that fear and make people feel they are being listened to, they are being taken seriously, I don't think... of course, there are some horrible people and there are some mad people, but most people are neither horrible nor mad. They're just decent people trying to lead their lives. And I think if you can persuade them that you're listening... I mean, I have not come across many people who are anti-immigration. When I'm outside England, I read that immigration was the big issue. Yes, immigration was felt to be in some way overtaken.
But aren't you then stuck in your bubble? Because, you know, I know a lot of people in the UK and I work with a lot of people from the UK who are expressing exactly the opposite of
what
you're
saying. Well, I think we're both stuck in our bubbles, if you don't mind my saying so. Because we can always find people who agree with
us. I'm not trying to look them up. Not at all.
I don't think we should be sidetracked by that. The main issue at the moment
is
the majority do not feel listened to. That's the main issue for you and for America and for England.
I tell you what is the main issue. The main issue is that if people and powerful forces in society are trying to use that people feel that they are not listened to or they are forgotten or they don't have a future, to use that to build walls, then that is a problem. And that is what was done in the US. That is what is done around Brexit, and that is being done in France.
It's the absolute opposite of what was done behind Brexit. And in fact, the established political class was totally anti-Brexit and totally in favour of staying in the EU. And in fact, it was a misunderstanding of the nature of the electorate that let them get it so wrong. They are absolutely the opposite of what you're saying.
Aren't you a part of the established political class?
Exactly.
Well, I am a member, I suppose, of the political class. Yes, I am. But I am also, you know, I hope, more in tune than some of them with the majority.
Do you know how it is to live on minimum wage? Have you ever?
I tell you this, I don't think I do know.
Okay.
But the difference is, I know I don't know.
I find this always so interesting. There's lots of people, most of the people that are in the sort of the established political class don't know how it is not to have the ends not meet at the end of the month, who don't know how it is not to be able to afford to go to the dentist or get a crisis if the tire breaks down because they have to choose.
Well, so, I agree with you on all of that, so I'm not going to take you on. I think that's completely right. And they have to somehow become alerted to what life is for an enormous number of people. And they're not alert to it at the moment.
I know, I agree. However, we agree on that.
I think this really is what people are talking about this week, and especially, of course, the American election. And another thing that you've been a part of and that played a part in the American election is WikiLeaks.
Well, I have not played a part with WikiLeaks.
I'm going to say that because you left the WikiLeaks some time ago, but you've been very active with them. For a while you were a spokesperson also. What I was going to ask you is that having that background, what are your thoughts on the role that WikiLeaks has played now in the American election, in effect helping Donald Trump to victory? Many people say that anyway.
I think that they went too far. And I could have understood it if the United States was interfering with a small country in their elections, that they would be sort of intense lobbying to try to stop that. But there we had two very strong powers.
I can't let this go on. I'm sorry. WikiLeaks was a profound betrayal of America. It was the act of a real traitor. And I really can't sit by and let someone talk about it as if this is arguably a positive and reasonable thing to have
done. I never said that.
You said it was acceptable.
No,
initially,
I never
said acceptable.
That. No, I never
well,
said that.
I think when I we said have WikiLeaks, the playback, we'll see it was.
WikiLeaks in the early days was an extremely important platform. Extremely. And if you disagree with that, then you can disagree with that.
Profoundly.
Yeah, okay,
are you talking
fine.
Now about WikiLeaks per se or about the American election?
Oh, no, WikiLeaks per se.
Per se, okay.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we disagree on that. They created a platform where it's safe to leak documents What has happened since then is the Panama Papers, for example. Are you in disagreement with that? The Panama Papers was extremely important. It was done in a beautiful way where you had investigative journalists from all over the world working on a very complicated issue that took 10 months to make sense of. And I think that if WikiLeaks had not existed, we would not see this type of work. So we have to look at things in a historical context, and that's what I'm doing. And I fully supported what WikiLeaks did back in 2009, 2010, 11, 12. But I do not agree with this presidential elections interference.
Well, I just hope you'll buy and read a copy of Belgravia. That's about my main contribution sure. to that.
Sure.
To WikiLeaks?
No, because I think it is absurd to talk as if you can govern a country by using traitors in order to release protected information.
Shame on you. Whistleblowers that blow the whistle on corruption in government and war crimes are not traitors. Shame on you.
Do you have that view on Panama Papers as well, that should never have happened?
I just feel the whole theory that you can run a country in this kind of amateur way...
No, but forget that theory. I ask you about the Panama Papers. Do you have that view on Panama Papers?
Well, I don't know if the Panama Papers is a good example. To that extent, I will concede it, in that to some extent, some kind of resolution seems to be coming out of it. But I just am incredibly uncomfortable with endorsing the whole concept of this method of conducting public life, and I'm sorry if you don't approve of that.
How much contact do you and Julian Assange have today?
None.
Would you consider him a friend?
We worked very closely for 5 months. He was in Iceland for about 5 months. I considered him a friend back then, but we have not been able to have communications for a long time.
But, I mean, now the internet is, as we talked about the US election, it's been used for political reasons. It's been used manipulative, and it gives a lot of power to... as an example, WikiLeaks.
But I don't think WikiLeaks has the responsibility of... We can't put the responsibility of how the elections went in the United States.
No, but when you have, do you agree that when you have power, you also have responsibility?
Absolutely.
Well, then they have responsibility as well, to some degree, right?
Just like any other media, they have responsibility, yes.
Do you think they are aware of that responsibility to the degree...
I don't know. I'm not living in the head of Julian Assange, you know. You have to ask him.
Well, you're the closest one here.
With great power comes great responsibility. I can't really go deeper into that, you know. There are so many pressing issues, and I see artists, and I want to see more artists and philosophers in politics, because one of the things we at least all have in common is that artists often have the ability to see things from a different perspective and offer different solutions.
Well, you have one artist in politics here.
Yes.
Birgitta, thank you so much for being with us here tonight. And thank you, Julian. Thank you so much.